Good morning, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, and Shabbat Shalom to all my Sabbath keepers out there. Now, today I want to do a teaching coming out of Ephesians 6. We spend a lot of time talking about children and their disobedience and honoring and not honoring their parents. But parents slash grandparents have to keep in mind that we all have a responsibility to our children also. So with that, I'm going to jump right in. Provoke. What does provoke mean? Simply put, by definition, it means to anger, enrage, exasperate, or vex, to stir up, arouse, or call forth feelings, desires, or activity. So simply, it means to incite or stimulate a person or animal to an action. And a lot of times these are aggressive actions. And when we're talking about people, they're aggressive in terms of the mouth, some vile and wicked things come out the mouth, or even worse yet, sometimes we can provoke our own children to physically attack us. Now, mind you, it is also upon us as individuals to have self-control. See, we can't just attack people because we don't like what they say or get fed up or frustrated with what they say. A whole lot of other things have led up to that, to where we lose self-control. But we can't let ourselves get in those positions to a tipping point gets to be someone provokes us and then we do something foolish, because that's what it is. We're held accountable for that. But still, parents slash grandparents, we are not to provoke our children, grandchildren, or what have you. So in Ephesians 6:4, Paul writes this. He says, fathers, mothers, grandparents, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So, to provoke to wrath or anger simply suggests what? It suggests a repeated, ongoing pattern of treatment that gradually builds up a deep-seated anger and resentment in children that usually results in an outward hostile display by children, be it they minors or adults. So we have to be very wary and aware of this type of thing, provoking other people. Adults do it to each other all the time, and it ends up in fights and altercations, people being shot, stabbed, killed. It is a very touchy situation, but we have to be aware of not creating these types of environment. When children are involved, like I said, minors or adults, when your children are involved, grandchildren, what have you, when this happens, most parents, in their own arrogance, proceed to do what? We proceed to take our superior position and authority because of our own self-importance and arrogance, pride, what have you, and we proceed to correct the children. Generally, as a child tries to explain that we provoke them, but see, we as a parent, we generally don't give any credence to that because we are caught up. See, and this is why the Father put this provision in His Word, because He knew and He knows that parents would get beside themselves and caught up in standing by, I have authority over you. You don't have the right to get upset with me because you don't like something I did. Really, that's why the Father said, provoke not your children to these types of behaviors, because we need to be held accountable also, or we would just treat our children any old kind of way and want them to be obedient, honorable, respectful, etc., etc. And that's not fair. These situations are usually not intended to provoke anger, but oftentimes parents can get too caught up in what they're doing, poking and prodding and all these things, and it generally ends up in a lot of hurt feelings and a bunch of drama. So, like I keep saying, we have to be very careful of this. So, what I'm going to do is talk about some ways in which parents can provoke their children to these types of angers and behaviors. Number one, parents who smother their children by being overly protective in where they can go and what they can do can fuel this type of resentment. Never trusting them to do things on their own, continually questioning their judgment. These types of restraints can build a barrier between you as parents and your children while you are under that delusion that you are building a closer relationship. Some parents honestly believe that they're building a stronger relationship by being so restrictive and smothering to their children, when in essence, they're building resentment and creating a separation. Now, children do need careful guidance and certain restrictions, but they are individual human beings in their own right, and they must learn to make decisions on their own. We, as parents, we have to weigh things according to their age and their maturity levels. We can't just lock them into a box because they are quote-unquote children. We have to take things into consideration. We have to factor in all the variables. Now, their wills can be guided, but they cannot be controlled. Trying to control children builds resentment. We have to guide them. We have to steer them. It's a very delicate balancing act, parents, grandparents, I'm telling you, especially in this world we live in today. See, we can allow them more freedoms, but we as parents and grandparents, we have to sacrifice more of our time. We have to be more of a monitor and more of a chaperone in some of these situations instead of being so restrictive and just not allowing them to do it because we don't want to sacrifice the time and put in the time to do what we have to do to allow them to do more of these things. We have to participate as necessary so that we don't create this barrier or this separation between us. Look, we cannot imprison our children because we don't want to invest the time to participate where it's necessary. We create them, so we have a huge responsibility, which includes a lot of sacrifice. We have to quit trying to have our life and restricting our children's life. We have to give more than we get because we created them. We are responsible. Number two, another common cause of provoking children to anger is what? Favoritism. Parents, a lot of you are so guilty of favoring one child over the other. Grandparents, some of you are so guilty of favoring one child over the other. We have to remember, children see it. You all remember, you saw who favored who over who. You saw children who favored other kids over other kids. You see it throughout your life. Don't think your children don't see you favoring one over the other. Grandparents, don't think your children don't see you favoring one of them over the other. Now, this is something that has never changed throughout mankind. Isaac favored Esau over Jacob, just like he was favored over his own brother Ishmael. But see, the mother, Rebecca, she preferred Jacob over Esau. See, this type of favoritism causes huge trouble and problems in families as it did then and it still does today. When one parent favors one over the other and the other one favors the other one over the other one, it creates all sorts of chaos and drama within households. It's never changed and apparently it's not going to change. Parents, you have to be very careful not to compare your children with each other, especially in other children's presence. Grandparents too, don't favor or show favoritism and compare children in each other's presence. You are setting them up for disaster. This can be devastating to the child who is what? Who is less talented or favored. It causes a lot of deep-rooted resentment. They can and may become what? Discouraged, resentful, withdrawn, and bitter. Colossians 3:21 tells us about this. It reads, it says, fathers, provoke not your children to anger. Mothers, grandfathers, grandmothers, whomever, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. See, the father covers all the angles. Don't do this to your children. Now, just because we see a greater talent or skill or knowledge or whatever in one as opposed to the other doesn't mean we have to rant about it from the rooftops out loud so that everybody hears it, everybody knows it. We know one is smarter than the other, one is more beautiful than the other. We're doing that with our eyes and with our judgment. We have to realize that the Father sees all of us as the same. And we have to look at our children as the same. Just because one is more talented or beautiful or this or that in the area, that's fine. But we don't demean the other one because of it. We don't overpraise the one because of it. We encourage and push forth these talents and skills and stuff reasonably, but we don't overdo it by creating problems between the children. Keep in mind, when we show favoritism as parents or grandparents, this generally leads to favoritism by the children themselves, who pick up this behavior, this practice, these habits from the parents or grandparents whom they're looking at. When they look at us and see this, they turn around and do the same thing. They will favor one brother or sister over another, or they'll favor one parent or over one or the other. We have to be very careful. This is a balancing act, people. Be very careful not to create these problems. Number three, the third way that parents provoke their children is by pushing achievement beyond reasonable goals or reasonable boundaries. Listen, a child can be so pressured to achieve that he is virtually destroyed. Some of you out here push way too hard for achievement because you're pushing toward achievements you want them to have. They may not be capable of some of these achievements. They learn very quickly or feel that nothing they do is sufficient to please their parents, grandparents, or whoever is the one pushing them. And no sooner than they achieve one thing or accomplish one goal, you're pushing them to achieve something even better. You've done this, now go do that. Now do that. I want you to be great. I want you to be wonderful. This is the type of thing that they're perceiving that you're doing to them. Fathers are very guilty of this one. Fathers sit around fantasizing about their own achievements or lack thereof through athletics. And they look at their sons and they push, wanting them to be basketball players, football players, whatever, baseball players. They want them to go to college and do this. They want them to become professional and do this. Fathers are very selfish in this type of pushing. Think about it. What if these kids don't want to do that? See, now we're pushing them to do things we want them to do because we're trying to live vicariously through our children. Mothers who fantasize about these glamorous careers through the lives of their daughters in terms of being models and beauty pageant queens and singers and all this stuff. Parents are very pushy when it comes to trying to put our own lack of achievements or desires or what have you on the children. Now think about this for a moment. Are you pushing your child or your children to be the next superstar athlete, like I said, singer, model, doctor, etc., because you were one, you want them to be better, or you didn't make it, or you want them to make it because you didn't, or you're looking at them as being physically perfect for that type of thing, so we push them toward that, or we push them toward this, or because your daughter has a beautiful voice and you want her to become a singer because she has the skill, she has the talent, she can make it, she can become all these things that you desire to be. And now we plant these seeds and we try and cultivate them and push them on these children, and then we have them believe this is what they want. All they're doing is trying to please you, the parent. But then what happens when they figure out they don't want to do these things? Now it becomes a conflict within the household, but they don't want to disappoint you, so they destroy themselves trying not to disappoint you. Now, just because your son is 6'6 and he's physically perfect in your view and estimation, but he doesn't like sports. But why are you, dad, trying to push him to be the next basketball player, football player, this, that, and the other? And he doesn't even like sports. See, we can't push our objectives on our children because we see something that can come from it, such as fame, stardom, dollar signs. Too many of you see dollar signs in your children when it comes to things like sports and success. You want your children to become all these things selfishly so that they can do for you. But you will never admit that. Most of you anyway will never admit that. So, if your daughter is the most beautiful girl you perceive in your eye, don't push her to become the next model or beauty pageant queen. Look at history. Look at the history of all these young women have been pushed to these things. Look at the history of so many of them that have become these things, and really look at how their lives have been destroyed and how they have been torn up inside and out, emotionally, physically, to achieve these things. See, we push them out here into these entertainments and all this, and we don't care about the consequences of a lot of this. It's not all the beauty it seems. It's not all the fun and fame that it seems. Some of this is truly wicked and it destroys our children. But some of us are willing to do it to our own greed and selfish desires. Number four, let's talk about discouragement. Children who are never complimented or encouraged by their parents are destined for trouble. Now, when we have children that don't jump out at us with skills and abilities and all these things, parents can be very ho-hum about encouraging and complimenting them. We have to come away from that. These are still your children. You gave birth to them. You created them. You can motivate them. You can compliment them and encourage them, because there's something good that all children do. There's something positive and wonderful about all children. When children are told what's wrong with them all the time and never what's right, this will eventually cause them to lose hope, and they will become convinced that they are incapable of doing anything right. You know what kind of life that's going to lead to. And most often, they end up not even trying because you have taken it away from them, that ability to try. You didn't encourage them or anything. Children need approval and encouragement in things that are good every bit as much as they need correction in things that are not. See, we have to balance that act. We can't always be on them for the negative and never balancing that with encouraging them with the good. But with that, I'm going to stop at those four, because there are four more that I want to go over, but I'm going to do a second part to this. So the bottom line is, we can't expect our children to automatically honor and respect us if at the same time we are not upholding our responsibility according to the Father's word as parents and or grandparents. Many of you parents are suffering the end results right now of failing in some of these areas when it came to or comes to your children as they're growing up or as they have grown up. But remember what Paul wrote in Ephesians 6:4. But bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. See, we have to bring up our children in the teachings and the ways of the Almighty. We're to teach them the information in what? We're to teach them the information in His Word, because this is what's truly holy or set apart, true and acceptable to Him, the Almighty. Forget about man. Focus on what's important to the Father. Do things right according to Him. And P.S., while at the same time not provoking them and discouraging them. Colossians 3:21. If we do this, then we should expect that they will honor and respect us as parents/grandparents. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.